everyone, and thank you for tuning into my channel today here on YouTube. This is the Painter in You channel, where I am here to teach you different art skills and techniques to help you find your inner artist. My name is Chris Papa, and today I'm going to teach you how to paint this dramatic waterfall landscape scene using acrylics. Now, before we get started, I always like to just give a heads up as to how long the painting took me to do. So this particular painting took me approximately 4 hours total. So expect it to take about the same amount of time if you're working with a similar sized canvas. This is an 18 by 24 canvas. And before you get started, I also want you to know that I left a link in the video description to a photo of this finished painting. And that's so that you can print it out and use it for reference as you're painting along with me. In addition, I left a couple other exciting links in the description. One is to my personal website, chrispapafineart.com, if you would like to see some examples of my other work. And I also left a link to the Painter in You Facebook group, which is a growing art community, primarily from viewers like you joining, and I am already starting to see that become a nice place for people to share their art and, you know, talk about art and painting. It's really great. So I really encourage you to join that as well. So why don't we go ahead and start our painting? Okay, so before we start painting, I always start by doing a sketch. And one thing I want to explain today that's very important when you're deciding what you want to paint, when you're doing a landscape, is your horizon placement. So as you can see, I've done two sketches here of kind of the same concept, but I want to explain the difference here. And you can see I kind of just put some labels. Now, real quick. So in this first sketch, you can see I placed the horizon pretty high. It's about a little more than halfway, maybe 60% up from the bottom of what's going to be the canvas. And then, as you could see, as a result, because it's further in the distance, now because that horizon's higher, your background here has to be smaller. And therefore, you're then stuck trying to figure out what you want to fill out all this foreground space with. Now, when I originally did the sketch, I decided, you know, I don't really want to do that. I don't want to be sitting here doing trees and flowers and rocks and streams. You may want to, but for this painting, I decided I don't want to. So I did a second sketch, and as you could see here, in the second sketch, the horizon's significantly lower. It's only about a quarter of the way up from the bottom of the canvas. And as a result, I could then make this sort of like mid-ground background area taller, and it gives the illusion that the waterfall is closer to you, and then I could spend a lot less time filling in all this foreground space. So I think I'm going to go with this one. As you can see here in the foreground, I just have a few little waterfalls and, you know, some close trees, and the background is really what's the majority of the painting, giving that illusion that it's a lot closer to you. So I know you're probably antsy to just start painting right away, but understanding these little tips and tricks really goes a long way. And, you know, thinking through at the beginning of what the painting is going to look like will make a much better final result in the end. I will leave links to both of these sketches in the description just so you can look at them in more detail and kind of understand this and study this concept. Okay, now with acrylic painting, you'll know this if you've watched any of my other video tutorials so far. You always have to do two coats of paint. So we're going to just paint through this entire thing really quick. We're just going to plow through this, just coating the entire canvas with a very, very high level underpainting. No detail at all, just really quick, just splashing it on there. So on my palette, I have some Prussian blue, titanium white, Mars black. This is, let's see, burnt umber, and Hooker's green. And I am going to take a pretty large brush, and a decent amount of water watering down my paint. As you know, I like to use aluminum foil on a clipboard as my palette. I find it so easy to clean up. You don't have to worry about scrubbing it. You just throw the foil out when you're done. And I'm going to start with a little tiny bit of Prussian blue because it's so strong. And the titanium white. This is going to be a nice daytime scene. And we're just going to fly through this. And the reason why is because we're going to go through the entire painting again. This is just a base coat. With acrylic painting, you always want to do two coats. Otherwise, your painting will have this kind of washed out look. Almost like watercolor. You know, I think I'm going to coin my own term here. I think I'm going to start calling this the throwaway coat. Because that's really what it is. You're just getting a base coat on there. And this is going to make your colors and your painting just look so much deeper and richer versus if this was the final painting. If I was just painting on the canvas. Okay, now continuing on this throwaway coat, I am going to start just putting in some darker, still pretty light, but darker distant mountains here, and then we're going to move on to these cliffs here that the waterfall is going to be on. I'm just really doing this with a slightly darker color. I'm just going to get a little ahead here and mark my horizon down here just so that I have a reference. This is a very watered down brown here. I'm just doing these sort of distant mountains. Again, this is the base coat. Do not go crazy with this. Just really quick. And make sure that with this coat, you're filling every little hole in the canvas. You see all these little canvas holes? Fill those all now so you don't have to worry about it later. This is a good time to do that. You know, I've learned myself a lot of the time as I go and do these videos, and I just tried a new technique. I took my Mr. Bottle, and I just sprayed some water directly on the canvas like this. And that actually made this really easy, because now look how easily the paint spreads. So that's a cool technique. I think I'm going to do that from now on. See, I'm learning with you as well, and that's what makes this fun. So again, the reason this first base coat is so important is you could pretty much see what's going on right here. Like, if I were just painting directly on the canvas, see how washed out this is right here? My painting, my final painting, would have that washed out look, and you can see the canvas through it. Now, I know some people might want to go for that look, but me personally, I like nice, deep, rich colors. And, you know, that's really not what I'm going for. So that's why I do this. And this is a good way, too, to, like, kind of get an idea of, like, where the painting's going early on. And, you know, you can change shapes and things here before you really invest too much time getting into fine detail. The sketch and this first coat are so important. This is probably the most important thing in the painting is, you know, this prep step here. So I'm just going to continue going on here. You know, again, these are just the cliffs. I am going to now mix a little bit of green. I might do some tree foliage up here because I'll probably have some trees coming up on this left side. I'm going to just keep going. Okay, now, as you can see, my canvas is completely covered, and I would now say we're done with this base, what I'm calling the throwaway coat.
It took me about 20 minutes to do this coat, and this is on an 18 by 24 canvas. So if you're spending any more time than 15 to 20 minutes for a canvas this size, you're putting way too much detail in. Now we are going to just let this dry for about 30 minutes to an hour till it is completely dry to the touch before we start on the next step where we're going to be doing all of the actual detail in the painting. Now that the painting has dried for about 30 minutes, it is completely dry to the touch, and we're going to now repeat a lot of those same steps, but this is now going to be the second and final coat of your painting. So now we're going to do a lot more detail than this initial base coat. So first we're going to go through the sky again, and I'm just using the same colors as before, Prussian blue and titanium white, and I'm going to use that same technique that I discovered earlier, where I'm going to just slightly mist my canvas. That'll just make it flow a little better. And I think this time I'm going to go a little lighter on the sky, especially in the lower section, closer to the mountains. So I'm going to just start right over here. Now you will end up covering these mountains a little bit, but that's okay. And make sure to use darker blue on the top. So as you get closer to the mountaintops, it's going to be more white. But as you're closer to this top sky section at the top of the painting, you're going to use a little more blue. Okay, and now we're done blending out the sky, and I'm just going to leave it as is. I'm not going to overcomplicate it with any clouds or anything. I want the focus in this painting to be on the waterfall in this foreground section here. And you can very quickly see, as we did that, how using the lighter color, this white, this very washed out white, whitish blue, blending in with the darker blue on the top gives a lot of depth into the painting. Okay, and now I'm going to move on to these background mountains, and I'm just going to kind of darken this up a little bit, but then I will be lightening it again. It is all about kind of going back and forth, and I'm doing some slightly different colors now. The more you vary your colors in your painting, the more realistic it will look. So this is just a mixture on my palette of sap green and burnt umber, and I'm just kind of like mixing those two together to come up with this sort of like dark green. And I'm using a sort of smaller medium-sized filbert brush for this step, and I'm just going to start going through and darken these mountains up a little bit. Now that's, even though they're in the distance, they're ultimately going to end up being lighter because we're going to put a lot of highlights on them. And now is also a good time to think about where your light source is going to be coming from, because the sides of the mountains that the light's hitting are going to be lighter. So what I'm thinking is that the light is going to be coming from the right going downward. So what I'm going to do is use a little more of the brown on these left sides of the mountains. And I'm going to leave this lower section lighter because I'm going to make it a little misty, I think. Like it's some mist coming up on the sides of the mountains. And while you're doing the scribbling, you can see I'm kind of doing these little like short brush strokes. And that's kind of giving some cool like texture, which is good because, you know, ultimately that will look like little cliffs and rocks and little things going on back in this distant mountain. Now using those same colors, I'm going to just lighten it up a little bit by adding a little bit of Naples yellow to that green. Now we're going to keep going here and just varying the colors light and dark and light and dark. Leave like dark gaps in between. One of the members that recently joined the Painter and You Facebook group asked me about how I make these mountains and things look so 3D. And my response to her was, perspective and light are the most important things. See, my light source, I'm keeping my light source in mind. So I'm going light, dark. You know, you have the light, the bright sides where the light's hitting, and then the dark sides where there's some, say, some shadow. Like, let's say that these are little rocks and cliffs and things. You know, the light is hitting the tops of them, but the sides of them still have some dark shadow. So look at how cool of a 3D effect that's giving, and how easy this is just by going alternating light and dark and light and dark. Here, let's demonstrate that over here in this middle section. I'm going to make this a lot brighter now with more white mixed in with the green. And watch, I'm going to go here on the very outer edge with the lighter green, right? Now I'm going to just skip a little dark spot right here and do more light again. And skip again and do more light again. And I'm leaving these like little dark spots in between. And that gives this really cool, like, three-dimensional effect. And you're going to keep progressively getting lighter and lighter and lighter. So we just went through that and did some sort of medium highlights. Now I'm going in with more white mixed in, and I'm just going to keep repeating those steps over and over again. Now, just on the very, very outer right sides, you can put some much brighter highlight. This is just a combination of straight Naples yellow and titanium white, but just a little tiny bit, so be really careful with this. And now I'm just kind of going again now, putting a little more of the dark back in, with just very, very light burnt umber again. Just kind of, it's like it's kind of watered down a little bit, and I'm just kind of scribbling it in on these like darker edges. And the very last step on this background section, and then I'm going to move on, is just adding some very faint mist. So what I'm doing is I'm going in through some titanium white, and I'm using a larger dry brush for this. Mine's a little wet, but it really should be dry. And just sort of dab the corner, kind of like that, and just really on the edge of that brush, only on one edge. Now taking that wet edge, it's just a little tiny bit of white. Don't put too much. That's too much, so now I have to wipe it. Little tiny bit. Just dab it like this in the back. And just lighten up this section. Now, I forgot to mention, you want to make sure that the paint from the last step is completely dry when you're doing this. Otherwise, you're going to get green mixing in with your mist, which you don't want. And what this is going to do is it's going to pretty much blend this background sky with the mountain. And it's going to give this really neat effect that there's mist coming around the mountain and evaporating up into the sky. I'm actually going to switch to a drier brush here, just for the blending. Next, we're going to move over to this cliff that's over here in the midground that the waterfall is going over. And the reason we're doing that next is because you need that to be behind the waterfall. So, on my palette, I picked some different browns. I have some burnt sienna that's sort of like a reddish brown, which is kind of cool. Mars black, and then burnt umber again. And I'm just kind of mixing all those colors together. Let's just kind of see what that gives us. I'm going to start going in here and putting in some cliff ledges. Okay, and I know the lighting is getting a little washed out now, as my painting is wet. But I'm just going to continue here and just finish this right side mountain. Then I'm going to let it dry so it'll be easier for you to see. See, even just with these shadows, you can already see the cliff ledge developing, and it's starting to look very realistic. I'm just keeping in mind, like, where, like, you know, it's going to be black here because the light is not hitting it, but on the top it's going to be a lighter brown, which is why I'm using Mars Black down here. And then I go into the burnt umber and I do the burnt umber up here on the top in this little ledge section. And then you can kind of like go like this to make it curve into it. Okay, so I let that layer of the rocks dry, and now we're just going to go through it again. As you're used to now, we go through and do the same steps multiple times. I'm going to go through again and give the rocks more highlight now with sort of a medium gray kind of tone. So on my palette, I just have some titanium white, Mars black, and Prussian blue, actually. We're going to give it kind of like a cool blue-gray. Just a tiny bit of the blue, though. Not that much. It's just really to kind of tint it. And I'm just going to start on like the left side here on some of these rocks at the top. And just start kind of highlighting them. That's a little too light. There we go, that's better. Kind of a medium gray. And pay attention to, like, now you can kind of start shaping like individual rocks. Okay, now, I know I kind of went through that a little quickly, but just like before in our mountains, the one key thing you just want to look for here is that you're alternating the light and the dark, and the shadow areas are what you're going to go in through with the dark. Now, you're just going to keep lightening the painting slowly, little by little, step by step. So, you saw we just did sort of that medium gray. Now I'm going to go through the whole thing again, and this time I'm using a slightly lighter gray. Okay, now I'm spending quite a bit of time on these rocks, as you could see, and I just did something really interesting here. So, you know how I keep talking about this alternating the light and dark, light and dark? Well, we talked a lot about that when you were, you know, just kind of painting, say, for example, right here, you know, you would do a light, skip the dark, do the light right here, you know, when you're painting directly where you're focusing. But you also have to think big picture here. So you could see that I did the alternating of the light and the dark between these two large cliffs. And I'm going to actually continue adding a little more here to make this brighter. So the sunlight is coming down from the right side here, right? It's hitting the side of these cliffs right here. But now those are shadowing this sort of little alcove over here. And this section I'm going to leave darker, but then it opens up again and this is out in the open. And so this is going to be highlighted brighter again. And you can see it gives this really cool depth effect here that, you know, this cool little alcove here that's darkened. So again, the alternating of the light and dark is so important, whether it be when you're looking at your painting as a whole, as I did here on these cliffs, or when you're shading specifically to one specific little tiny area, whether it be up in the mountains or on the rocks. That's how you're going to get all this really awesome detail that people are just going to look at and go, wow. So I'm just going to keep going here, highlighting this cliff a little more. I'm probably going to leave this the way it is. I might put a few tiny highlights just on the top here. Then I still have this entire right side to do. So I'm just going to keep going here. And, you know, it's really the same technique just over and over again, just going with the medium grays and then just keep lightening it over and over again. Okay, now, as you could see, I again did the same thing here, right? I'm going with the light and the dark and the light and the dark. And I highlighted, like, the faces of these rocks, right? Because the sun is hitting them. And then you just insert sort of like a dark spot in between each one. And now I'm just going in with the black here. And we can say, all right, here's like a cliff. This is the shadowed edge where the waterfall now is going to be coming down. So see, the waterfall is going to be hidden now, like, on the side of this little rock ledge, right? See how three-dimensional that looks with the bright edge here and then the dark shadow here? I'm going to lighten it just a little bit, though. Maybe just come back here again and just lighten that right like that. Just want that shadow to be kind of small where the waterfall is kind of hiding in that little rock ledge right there. See that? And I'm just going to continue. I'm almost done with the rocks. All I have left really is just this section down here. I'm going to leave it kind of dark because I like this effect that it's giving, that we're kind of like in this little valley section here where the waterfall's coming down. It's really cool. You may notice, too, that when I paint, I find myself just scribbling a lot with my brush. Like, I just scribble it, almost like I'm coloring. And, you know, you just kind of, a lot of artists just go really carefully just like this on that tip of the brush. But I like to scribble in. It gives you a lot more control. The only downside to that, though, is it does damage your brushes over time. So I do find myself having to buy new brushes a little more frequently doing this, but I don't care because my painting comes out so much better, so I am okay with having to buy a new brush here and there. And another thing, too, is I don't use expensive brushes at all. I mean, I buy most of my brushes at Michael's. They have a really good selection there, and you know, like, even the cheap brushes do a good job. I don't buy the ones that come in, like, big bags of, like, you know, 10 brushes in one bag. I find those are a little cheap, and will be difficult to work with. But if you go and buy the ones that are sold individually, even if you're getting the cheaper ones that are sold individually, I think at Michael's, I know every art store is a little different, but I know at Michael's, they label them like student, beginner, artist, and professional or something like that. Like, even if you buy the cheaper ones, you know, they're still pretty good. Like, I think this is a cheap one. Yeah, see, this one says level one on it. It still has the price tag on it from when I bought it there. Another thing you're going to find is, like, when you're watching a lot of YouTube videos, a lot of artists have, like, brush lines and things like that. Like, I know, like, the Bob Ross, like, that even has its own brush line. I know there's also a few others. I just mentioned the Bob Ross one because that's been around for years and years. But one thing you need to know is that's really just a big marketing scheme. I mean, buying the brushes, yeah, okay, they're probably good brushes. I'll give it that. But buying the brush isn't what's going to make you a good painter. What's going to make you a good painter is practicing and learning how to become a good painter on your own. The brush, yeah, you know, you might have one that's a little bit better quality that will help you a little bit and will make it look a little bit better. But it's really you understanding how to work with light, perspective, colors, all the stuff that makes a painting. And that's what's going to make you a good artist, not buying some special, you know, canvas or brushes or something like that. Okay, now we only have a few steps left, and I think we're going to go in this order. We're going to first do the water down here, then I think we're going to do the waterfall finally, and then I think we're going to do some, like, little grassy patches here, and we still have to finish these trees, but that shouldn't take too long. So, for the next step, which is the water, I have on my palette some white, burnt umber, and phthalo blue. That's going to give us a nice dark teal tone. I am going to leave this pretty dark down here just because it, you know, it's like totally shadowed and hidden. So I'm just kind of going back here. And you want your waterline to be completely horizontal against the rocks. I'm using phthalo blue for my teal, but any blue will work. You know, you could use the Prussian blue again or ultramarine or whatever you want. And don't go too crazy back here because it's going to end up getting covered with mist from the waterfall. Okay, now using those same colors, but just with a little bit of white, you can kind of start going in now and doing highlights on the water. See, by putting in these highlights, you're really defining now the bottom edges of these rocks coming in. So, see, watch, if I highlight just like going in here, it basically flattens out and boxes in that bottom of that rock right there. And I'm just doing this all along all of the edges here. Okay, now the moment you've all been waiting for, we are finally going to do the waterfall. So the first step is I'm going to start by doing kind of like the background water. I'm going to use some similar colors that we used in this water down on the pool on the bottom. So on my palette, I'm going in again through that same mixture of the titanium white, burnt umber, the phthalo blue, and I'm going to add a tiny, tiny, almost unnoticeable touch of crimson red to give almost like a purpley hue to it. But it's very, very little crimson, so that you really don't even see it. This is going to give us a nice dark kind of purpley teal. And I'm just going to quickly go in through here. And just fill in the whole waterfall. And even with this, I might even leave some of the black behind it from the underpainting. But this waterfall is going to be a lot brighter just because the water is rushing so fast and it's like foaming and misting and creating all kinds of like white. This again is that same filbert brush I've been using for most of the painting now. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take kind of a rough fan brush. So I'm working with that same color mixture we were just working with, but this time I'm lightening it up a little bit with more white. And actually quite a bit of white. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start at the very top here with this fan brush in this corner and just go horizontally where the water's flowing over the edge of the cliff. And then I'm gonna sort of flatten the fan brush and just start pulling down. See, now that's gonna give us individual little streams of water, these kind of like little vertical lines. I'm actually going to try something else now. I'm going to try going through this with the dagger striper brush. This has a sharp angled edge, and it's really good for painting vertical lines. So I'm going through pretty much just like pure white now. And let's see how this goes. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in with this larger dry brush. I used this earlier when we did the mist in the mountains, but it has dried since. And I'm actually going to put in some mist the exact same way we did before in the mountains. So you're just taking this brush and just going in with like the corner of it, and it's a dry brush. Now we're going to probably want to put a lot of mist here. So in the waterfall now, I'm just going to start dabbing in mist on the sides of it. Might even be easier to start on the bottom and then do less and less mist as you get closer to the top. Okay, now we're going to start filling in some of these trees here on the left. And to do that, I think we're going to start with the trunks. Now, I'm using the dagger striper brush for this step. And on my palette, I have burnt umber, Mars black, and unbleached titanium white. So I'm just going to start going in with this brownish mixture. Just sort of sketching in the tree trunks. I'm also just going in now and adding a little bit of dark back on the left side of these trunks. It is again about just going back and forth till you find the right balance. All right, so while I was doing those trunks, I kind of decided that this right side of the painting is going to look a little off balance and bare if I don't put some trees here too. So I'm going to go through and pretty much just do the same thing, but before I do, I just need to kind of like darken up a little bit just to kind of put some leaves and shadow in there. So I'm kind of going through with the same colors that I did my underpainting with. Okay, and now that our tree trunks are done, I'm really happy with how that came out. I think we're going to just go through all of these trees and just add some leaves. So on my palette, I just have some Hooker's Green and Yellow Ochre, and I just, you know, I'm going to go through these trees here with like a darker green first, and then keep lightening up them up with yellow and highlights in the leaves. So I actually just mixed also a tiny bit of Mars Black with the green to give me kind of a slightly darker green. So as you can see, I'm just mixing some black here where needed, you know, kind of on these left sides here to give more shadow before I do the highlighting. And another cool thing I did here you might have noticed is I took that Hooker's Green and I just sort of like went in a little bit in these little sections between the trunks. That just gives some indications of some leaves and, you know, some trees that are more in the background behind these main trees here in the front. Okay, now that I got like that original base coat of the green onto the leaves, I'm just going to go through the whole thing again now, but I'm lightening up that green with some yellow ochre, and I'm going to start highlighting on the right side of the leaf branches and things like that. Okay, now a little trick here is when you do this with the filbert brush, you end up with these little like brush marks, these little like arc like marks where you could see like where the brush was. If you take a dry brush and just blend it out, it gives it a nice, softer look. So watch this. See, that cleaned up those weird little brush marks. So I'm going to just continue doing that as I paint in these leaves. And now we're just going to add a little bit of grass on these little ledges here. I'm going to do this with this really rough brush that I use for painting grass. But you can use a fan brush or, you know, all different kinds of brushes. I just like this one because it has like the individual separate hairs, almost like grass, so it makes it really easy. You can highlight the grass just by going with a slightly lighter color and just doing the same motions. Now, if you want to really give some individual grass blades, you can go in with your script liner brush and do individual grass blades like this. This is really good for the grass that's closer to you because it's going to be longer since it's closer to you, so you want it to be more visible to the person viewing the painting. So you just put these longer blades in. And now with just a little watered down sap green, I'm going to just scribble in a little bit of green highlights on some of these ledges to look kind of like moss. And this is pretty watered down. You want it to almost be like transparent. So you're just, you could still see the rock formations underneath it. All right, well, I think I'm gonna say the painting's done now. I'm really happy with how it came out. You could keep going if you want and do all kinds of, you know, really cool things. You could add more shrubs and bushes. You could maybe add some flowers here in the grassy section. It's totally up to you. You could do whatever you want. But I think it looks good the way it is now. And so last but not least, just sign your painting in the location of your choosing. I think I'm going to sign it on the lower left here.
Thank you again for tuning in today. I really hope you learned something new. I certainly had a lot of fun doing this painting, and I hope that you did too. Please remember to subscribe, and please check out the links in the description. Thank you, and I look forward to seeing you in my next video.